Welcome to the Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we'll be analyzing the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper, dated 27th July 2019. The topics to be discussed today are reflected on your screen and the timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. So let's begin. Now continuing with our prelims 2019 discussion. This question appeared as question number 49 in set B of the 2019 prelim examination. This question is providing us with three pairs of an animal and the river in which they are naturally found. The first option is blue-finned mahseer and the Kaveri River. Now this is correctly matched. Second is Irrawaddy dolphin and the Chambal River. Now this is incorrect. And third is rusty spotted cat and the Eastern Ghats. Now this is correct. Hence the right answer to this question was C, 1 and 3 only. Now you could have easily solved this question if you would have watched the DNS dated 21st January 2019. In this DNS, we spoke about the Irrawaddy dolphin. And in this DNS, it was clearly mentioned that the Irrawaddy dolphin gets its name from the Irrawaddy River, which is a freshwater river flowing in the country of Myanmar. In this DNS, we also showed you a map wherein all this yellow colored area is the habitat where the Irrawaddy dolphin is found. Now, if you will look at option number 2, it says Irrawaddy dolphin is found in the Chambal River. But as you must be knowing, Chambal River is a tributary of the river Yamuna, which is found in central India somewhere in Madhya Pradesh. Hence, it is but obvious that Irrawaddy dolphin cannot be found in the Chambal River. So therefore, if you could eliminate that Irrawaddy dolphin and Chambal River are the incorrect option, then automatically you could eliminate option number A, B, and D, because all these options have option number 2 as one of the correct options. Hence automatically the right answer would become C, 1 and 3 only. Now let's begin with today's newspaper analysis. This news is an editorial appearing on page number 10 and is in respect with the ongoing Karnataka government's issue. Now this entire Karnataka government issue is very political in nature. However, this Karnataka issue has brought up very important concepts of polity and governance in the forefront. Hence, as part of our discussion, we will be discussing such important concepts by taking the example of this Karnataka government situation. This entire discussion of ours will become very relevant from the perspective of both the prelims examination as well as mains under GS paper 2. In order to make sure that you are in a better position to understand the various concepts which we will be discussing, let us very briefly look at how things unfolded for the Karnataka government. As per the news and other updates, at least 16 MLAs of the Congress-JDS coalition tendered their resignation to the Speaker. After getting the resignation, the Speaker of the House said that some of the resignation were not in the required format. Following the Speaker's decision, the rebel MLAs went to the Supreme Court and challenged this decision of the Speaker to declare their resignation invalid. Following this, certain other political developments happened, after which finally it was stated that a floor test or a trust vote will be called for by the H.D. Kumaraswamy-led coalition government. Next, an important development happened in this issue. The Supreme Court in its hearing said that it is the rebel MLA's discretion whether they want to attend the floor test or not. Hence, in a way, the Supreme Court gave them the exception to defy the party's whip. And then finally, the H.D. Kumaraswamy-led government lost the trust vote. And now, B.S. Yediyurappa has been sworn in as the chief minister by the governor and will soon face the floor test to prove his majority. Now, in this entire incident, two, three issues and concepts have come to the fore. Namely, the anti-defection laws, the discretion of the governor to call upon a party to form the government, the concept of a whip, as well as the floor test or the trust vote. So let us look at them one by one. Now a whip in parliamentary parlance is a written order that a party member must be present for a vote or that the party members vote in a particular manner only. Now every political party has its own office of whip in the parliament. And this whip has the responsibility to regulate and monitor the behavior of the members of that party in the parliament. Therefore, a whip is charged with the responsibility of ensuring the attendance of his party members as well as securing their support in favor or against a particular issue. Now, usually a party appoints a senior member to hold the office of the whip and this member is known as the chief whip, and he and she is assisted by the additional whips. Now, this office of whip is not defined in the constitution, and neither it is defined in the rules of procedure of the house. Therefore, the office of the whip is based on the conventions of parliamentary governments. Next, every political party, whether it's the ruling party or the opposition party, has an office of whip. Now, the importance of a whip can be inferred from the number of times an order is underlined. So, for example, if an order is underlined only once, then a one-line whip is usually issued to inform the party members about a vote. That is to simply inform the party member that a vote is going to happen. One-line whip is issued. Now, in a one-line whip, the party members have the discretion whether they want to attend it or they want to abstain. Hence, the members can also abstain if they decide that they do not want to follow the party line. Next, a two-line whip directs the party members to be present during a vote. And finally, a three-line whip, which is the strongest one, places an obligation on the party members to vote in a particular manner. And this three-line whip is usually employed on important occasions such as the second reading of a bill or a no-confidence motion. Now, what happens if a party member defies the whip? Now, the penalty for defying a whip varies from country to country. In India, if the members do not follow the directives given by the whip, disciplinary action can be taken against them. In fact, rebelling against a three-line whip can also put that legislator's membership of the house at risk. In fact, the anti-defection law provided under the 10th schedule allows the speaker or the chairperson of a house to disqualify such a member if he disobeys the whip. Therefore, the penalty for defiance ranges from disciplinary action to the disqualification of the member itself from the house. Now, having discussed whip, let us very briefly look at anti-defection law. In this entire Karnataka government issue, questions have been raised regarding the speaker's conduct when it came to accepting the resignation letters of the rebel MLAs. We will see what those issues are, but before, let us look at anti-defection law very briefly. Now, anti-defection law has been provided for in the 10th schedule. The 10th schedule has given certain grounds for disqualification. The first is that if a member belonging to a political party voluntarily gives up the membership of his political party. Second is that if the party member votes contrary to the directions of his political party. So the second clause is the clause which is related to the whip, which we discussed earlier. And in the present Karnataka government issue, this clause of whip was exempted by the Supreme Court. Because if you will recall, we discussed that the Supreme Court allowed the rebel MLAs the discretion of whether they want to attend the floor test or not. The other disqualification is if an independent candidate joins a political party after the election, or if a nominated member joins a party 6 months after he becomes a member of the legislature. Further, as far as the power to disqualify is concerned, it lies with the chairman or the speaker of the house, whose decision is final but again is open to judicial review, as was held in the Kohoto-Holohan case. Next, certain exceptions are given, the foremost of which is a merger, and a merger will be applicable only if not less than 2/3 of the member of the party agree for the merger. Now, in the Karnataka government issue, the Speaker of the House has disqualified 3 members under the anti-defection law. But additionally, what the Speaker did was that he fixed the period of disqualification for these 3 members. The Speaker said that the disqualified MLAs cannot contest elections until the expiry of the term of the 15th Assembly, that is the present Assembly. So this basically means that they cannot contest the polls until May 2023. However, what is to be noted here is that the 10th schedule or the anti-defection law does not give Speaker the power to fix the period of disqualification. Under the anti-defection law, the Speaker may only declare a person to have incurred certain disqualification. In fact, disqualification under the anti-defection law is not accompanied by ineligibility to contest. Now, we know that the Constitution provides for certain ground of disqualification. But unlike some forms of disqualification, where the disqualification leads to the person being ineligible to contest an election, under the anti-defection law, such ineligibility is not there. In fact, under the anti-defection law, the one who is disqualified can also contest in the very same by-election which is caused by his own disqualification. Which simply means if I am an MLA and I am disqualified, then the seat which has become vacant due to my disqualification, then for that seat, I can again contest in that by-election. So this is the first issue related to fixing of the time period disqualification by the speaker. Now coming to the second issue of resignations. Now in this case, the MLAs had tendered their resignation, but the speaker took a lot of time to decide on the fate of their resignation. Therefore, the author is saying, given the fact that no time limit has been provided in the constitution within which the speaker has to decide upon the resignation of the MLAs, this leads to delay in the acceptance of the resignation, and such a delay is purposely caused by a speaker until a point where the member concerned is seen as voluntarily giving up his membership. To better understand this point, you first need to understand what is the difference between a resignation and a disqualification. Now, both in a resignation and in a disqualification, the seat of that member becomes vacant. That is, the member is no longer the part of the house. But the major point here is that when a member resigns, then that member can become a minister before the conduction of the by-election. So if today a MLA resigns and his resignation is accepted, then he can become a minister before a by-election is conducted and he is again elected to the house. And this flows from the provision of Article 164 Clause 4, which says that a minister who for any period of 6 consecutive months is not a member of the legislature of the state shall at the expiration of that period cease to be a member. So under 164 Clause 4, a person can first become a minister and then within 6 months he has to become the member of the legislature. However, such is not the case for disqualification. Article 164 Clause 1b clearly states that a person who has been disqualified for defection cannot become a minister without being re-elected to the house. So if you are being disqualified under defection, you first have to be re-elected to that house and only then can you become a minister. The reason for such a provision was that a lot of political parties used to lure the members of the other parties by promising them a ministerial post. Hence, to discourage members from defecting just for the purpose that they will be given an immediate ministerial post, the government inserted this clause 164.1b. So now when we come back to this point of ours, now the speaker in a way, by delaying the acceptance of their resignation, is trying to make it look that these members are voluntarily giving up the membership of the house so that these members can be disqualified. Because as we had studied, voluntary giving up of membership of the political party is a ground for disqualification under the anti-defection law. Now the second issue is in relation to the form in which the resignation is tendered. Now the author in this article has asked a very important question. That is, can a speaker reject the resignation if that resignation is in the correct form and is also handed over in person to the speaker? Under the rules of procedure of the Karnataka Legislative Assembly, it is stated that any member who wishes to resign his seat, he has to intimate to the speaker in writing under his hand about his intention to resign his seat. Further, you should know that it is also stated that no reason for the resignation should be given. Now, a similar provision is reiterated under Article 190, Clause 3, Subclause B, wherein it states that a member can vacate his seat if he resigns by writing under his hand addressed to the speaker about his intention to vacate the seat. However, the proviso to this article further states that if the Speaker of the House feels that such a resignation is not voluntary or genuine, then the speaker can reject that application. Please note another thing, that this proviso was not present in the original text of the article, and this element of acceptance of resignation was introduced only via the 33rd Constitutional Amendment Act of 1974 to place a check on any forced resignation. So earlier it was not important for the speaker to accept or reject the resignation, but now the speaker has to accept it. And further, if the speaker feels that this is not voluntary or genuine, then he can reject it also. So hence the issue is now, does the power to scrutinize a resignation letter for its voluntary nature even extends to the speaker rejecting that resignation letter, even if the resignation letter was in the correct form and was handed over to the speaker in person? So this is one question which has come up. Another small thing, please keep in mind that the articles which we refer to were in relation to the state government. But when it comes to the union government, the corresponding article to Article 190 becomes Article 101, Clause 3, Subclause B. Article 164, 1B becomes Article 75, 1B. And Article 164, Subclause 4 becomes Article 75, Subclause 5. Let us now talk about the flow test. Now coming to a flow test, usually the terms flow test, trust vote and confidence motion are used synonymously. Now a confidence motion is a motion through which the ruling government seeks to know whether it still enjoys the confidence of the house or not. So basically a motion which is used to test the majority in the house is known as a confidence motion. Now if there are doubts against the chief minister, the governor can ask the chief minister to prove his majority in the house. Now you should know that this confidence motion has not been defined in the constitution, and in fact even the Lok Sabha rules do not mention confidence motion but rather talk about no confidence motion. So in a way, the flow test flows from Article 75, which clearly states that the Council of Ministers shall be collectively responsible to the Lok Sabha. Hence in a way, the confidence motion is an antithesis to the no confidence motion. So now coming to what is no confidence motion. A no confidence motion is a motion which is sought by any member of the house to express lack of confidence in the ruling government. So from here you should be clear that if the government wants to demonstrate its strength on the floor of the house, then it is known as a confidence motion. However, if any member feels that he wants to express the lack of confidence in the Council of Ministers, then that member moves a no confidence motion. Now the no confidence motion has been defined under Rule 198 of the Rules of Procedure and Conduct of Business of the Lok Sabha. So therefore no confidence motion has not been defined or mentioned in the Constitution. And just like the confidence motion, even the no confidence motion is based on Article 75. Now you should know that the no confidence motion can only be moved in the Lok Sabha. And further, this motion needs the support of 50 members in order to be admitted. Further, this motion can be passed by a simple majority of the House. And if it is passed, then the Council of Ministers have to resign immediately. Another thing, please remember that it can be moved only against the Council of Ministers as a collective whole and not against individual members. So this was all about the Karnataka government's issue. With this, let's move on to our next news. This news appears on page number 12 and reads, Private Bill Urges State Election Funding. Now this discussion of ours will become relevant from the perspective of GS Paper 2. Now the context of the news is that a private member's bill has been introduced in the Rajya Sabha to make amendments in the Representation of the People's Act in order to allow for state election funding. Now state election funding means that it is the government of our country which gives funds to the political parties and the candidates to contest and fight elections. Now currently in India, indirect public funding is already practiced, and indirect public funding includes access to publicly owned media, use of government buildings for meetings and rallies, free or subsidized public transportation for candidates, free printing and distribution of ballot papers, etc. However, under the direct funding scheme, the state provides money directly to the political parties or the candidates to fully or partially meet their expenses. So let us now first look at the advantages or the reasons as to why state election funding is required. The number one reason is that having state election funding will provide a fair or an equal level playing field for all the candidates. Because we know that in India, financial superiority means an electoral advantage. So therefore, richer candidates and their parties have a greater chance of winning elections. But through state election funding, we can ensure that everybody gets equal amount of money so that they can fairly contest the elections. Hence, in a way, it will lead to political equality. Second, it will increase the transparency in our country. Since the government will be paying for the election expenditure, hence there will be a transparency as to where the money is coming from. The third point is related to the second one, that increase in transparency will reduce corruption and black money. It is a well-known fact that political funding is used as a backdoor for black money transactions. Further, political funding also leads to bribery and corruption. Fourth, it will help to reduce the corporate influence on our politicians. Because with political funding, there is usually a quid pro quid corruption, wherein the business groups who are funding the election expenses of the political party expect favors from the political party when they come in power. And the fifth advantage is that it will help to eliminate criminal politics as well. Because not many times, candidate takes up criminal activity to generate huge amount of money to fund their elections. So therefore, if elections will not require money from individual candidates, hence there will be no need for criminal activities. However, stating the advantages or the needs by state election funding, there are certain disadvantages or challenges also associated with state election funding. The first is the high fiscal burden. Many experts feel that the government is already dealing with a huge amount of fiscal deficit, and in such a scenario, providing money to political parties for contesting election will further add on to this fiscal burden. Secondly, it is felt that this will lead to diversion of funds from the social causes. Hence, considering the fact that the state expenditure on key social sectors such as health and education is already really very small, and on top of this, the government providing money for the elections is a very revolting idea. Third is that it can also lead to undisclosed funding, because what will happen is that political parties will take the funds from the government also, but at the same time, they will not stop taking funds from other big corporate houses, and hence will get undisclosed additional funds from the private sector. And the fourth disadvantage is that this provision can be misused, where the state funding can encourage every person to enter the political arena just to avail the state funds instead of aiming to win the election and undertake welfare activities. Now, coming to what were the earlier recommendations regarding the state election funding. The first such recommendation for state election funding came from the Indrajit Gupta Committee, which was constituted in the year 1998. Now, this committee endorsed state funding of elections. However, it recommended certain limitation. The limitation was that the state funds should be given only to the national and state parties who have been allotted symbols and not to independent candidates. Further, it said, for the short-term state funding, funds should only be given in kind, in form of certain facilities, and that too only to recognize political parties and their candidates. Further, the committee noted that the economic situation of the country is only suited for a partial funding and not full state funding. The second recommendation came from the 1999 Law Commission report, which said the state funding of election is desirable as long as the political parties do not take funds from other sources. And the third time state election funding was mentioned in the report titled Ethics in Governance, which was part of the second Administrative Reforms Commission. This report also advocated for partial state funding of election for the purpose of reducing illegitimate and unnecessary funding of election expenses. Now, coming to what this current bill wants, this current bill aims to do two things. Firstly, it wants to remove the current expenditure limit of 70 lakh rupees per candidate. So this bill wants that there should be no expenditure limit per candidate. And secondly, it wants to have state funding of elections in order to ensure a cleaner polity. Now, for the information of new aspirants, you should know that a private member's bill is a bill which is introduced by a member of parliament who is not a minister. That is, a member who is not a member of the government. That person's bill is known as a private member's bill. So therefore, we have two kinds of bill. One is the government bills, which are the bills introduced by the ministers. And then we have private member's bill, which are the bills introduced by the members of parliament. So this was all about this topic. Let's move on to our next news. This news appears on page number 12 and reads, Companies Bill tightens the CSR compliance. So basically, the Lok Sabha has passed the Companies Amendment Bill of 2019. And this is amending the Companies Act to bring in certain reforms. Now, since the bill is still pending in the parliament, we will not be talking about the entire components of the bill, and we'll only be looking at the changes which are proposed related to the corporate social responsibility and the National Financial Reporting Authority. Now, corporate social responsibility has been provided for under Section 135 of the Companies Act of 2013. To simply put, corporate social responsibility is a management concept whereby companies integrate social and environmental concerns in their business operations and interactions with their stakeholders. In fact, India is the first company to make corporate social responsibility spending mandatory through a law. Now, Companies Acts provide that all those companies which are registered under the Companies Act and and have a net worth of 5,000 crores or more, or turnover of rupees 1,000 crore or more, or a net profit of 5 crores or more during any financial year, will have to spend 2% of their average net profits, which were made during the three immediately preceding financial years, in pursuance of its corporate social responsibility policy. So CSR is applicable to companies who have net worth of 500 crores or more and turnover of 1000 crores or more, or net profit of 5 crores or more. And all these companies will have to spend 2% of their last 3 years' profit towards fulfilling their corporate social responsibility goals. Now the Act states, company will have 1 year to solidify and come out with a CSR proposal, and then they will have another 3 years to spend the funds. And in case it is being found out that money which was reserved for the CSR is not being used, then that money will be moved to an escrow account. Further, the Act also states that if the companies are not fully spending the funds meant for the CSR, then they must disclose the reasons for not spending such funds in their annual reports. Now, the changes which the bill has proposed is that firstly, the bill says that any unspent annual CSR funds must be transferred to one of those funds under Schedule 7 of the Companies Act. Now, Schedule 7 of the Companies Act provides for all those activities which can be included by the companies in their corporate social responsibility, and includes funds like the PM Relief Fund. Further, the bill states that if it is found out that the CSR funds are committed to certain ongoing projects, then the unspent funds will have to be transferred to an unspent CSR account within 30 days at the end of the financial year, and then they have to be spent within 3 years. Further, the bill states that any violation of such rules can attract fine between 50,000 to 25 lakh rupees. And lastly, the central government has been empowered to give such general and specific directions to any company or class of companies which it thinks is necessary to ensure compliance to the provisions of the CSR. Now, since the bill is still pending, the provisions of the bill can be used as a recommendation if a question comes on tightening of the compliance of CSR. However, from the perspective of the UPSC, you should know what corporate social responsibility is all about. Now, the next major provision which the bill talks about is that the National Financial Reporting Authority should be allowed to debar auditors. Now, the bill states that the National Financial Reporting Authority should be able to perform its function through various divisions and executive body. Now, currently, the Companies Act states that the NFRA can debar a member or a firm for practicing as a chartered accountant for a period which will vary from 6 months to 10 years. Now, the bill has kept this provision the same. The only thing what it is doing is that it is specifying and making it more clear as to what class of people can be debarred by the National Financial Reporting Authority. Hence, the bill says that the NFRA can provide for debarment from appointment as an auditor or an internal auditor of a company, or performing a company's valuation for a period of 6 months to 10 years. So even earlier, the NFRA was allowed to debar, and the bill has continued with that power of NFRA. The only thing is that it has made it more clear, lucid, and has tried to fill in any kind of ambiguity. Now let us see what is National Financial Reporting Authority. Now, NFRA is a statutory body which has been constituted by the central government under Section 132 of the Companies Act of 2013. The main aim of the body is to enforce accounting and auditing standards, and also to have an oversight of the work of the auditors. Hence, the NFRA is known as the Auditor of Auditors. Now, the main functions of the NFRA is firstly, as stated, to recommend accounting and auditing standard, ensuring compliance, and also overseeing the quality of service of the accounting and auditing professions. Further, the NFRA has been given the power to investigate matters of professional misconduct by the chartered accountant or the CA firm, and further impose a penalty or debar the CA or the firm up to 10 years. As far as the constitution of the NFRA is concerned, it will consist of a chairperson who has to be a person of eminence and having expertise in accounting and auditing, and it will have such other members who will not exceed 15 in total, consisting both of part-time and full-time members. Further, the NFRA can investigate a matter either suo moto, that is on its own cognizance, or on a reference made to it by the central government. Further, the NFRA shall have the same power which are vested in a civil court under the Code of Civil Procedure. So, from your exam point of view, you should remember details about the NFRA. With this, let's move on to our next news. This news appears on page number 8 and is in reference with the Coastal Regulation Zone norms. This entire discussion of ours will become important from the perspective of GS Paper 3 under the category of Environment. The context of the news is that Supreme Court in May had ordered the demolition of 5 apartment complexes in Ernakulam in Karnataka for violating the Coastal Regulation Zone norms. This order came on a special leave petition which was filed by the Kerala Coastal Zone Management Authority. Now, yesterday only, Supreme Court has reaffirmed its May order and has further stated that such apartments have to be demolished. Hence, in this respect, let us see what are the coastal regulation zones. Now, since coastal areas are very ecological sensitive zones, in order to regulate development activities in such area so that environmental balance can be created, the government came out with coastal regulation zone norms. Now, as per the norms, all the coastal zones within 500 meters of the high tide line on the landward side are classified into 4 categories. So, if this is the land and this is the sea and somewhere here is the high tide line, then from this high tide line, 500 meters towards the landward side will be known as the coastal zones, and these coastal zones are divided into 4 categories. In the first category are all those areas which are very ecologically sensitive and important. These would include areas such as national park, sanctuaries, marine parks, mangroves, etc. The second area included in category 1 will be all those areas likely to be inundated due to rise in the sea level consequent upon the global warming, and further any other such area which will be declared so by the central government. And the third area included in the coastal regulation zone number 1 will be the areas that lie between the low tide line and the high tide line. So if here is the high tide line and here is the low tide line, then even all such areas will be included in the zone 1. So basically zone 1 has 3 categories. Firstly, areas which are ecologically sensitive and important. Second, areas which are likely to be inundated or flooded due to rise in the sea level. And third, area lying between the low tide and the high tide line. In the second category are all those areas that have already been developed close to the shoreline. Hence, all those areas which lie close to the shoreline and have already been developed will fall under category 2. Category 3 will include all those areas which are relatively undisturbed, and further all those areas which do not belong to either category 1 or category 2. Now, here is an important thing which you need to know. Under the category 3, all those coastal zones in the rural area, whether they are developed or undeveloped, will fall. Further, even the areas within the municipal limits or other legally designated urban areas, that will also fall under CRZ 3. Category 4 include the coastal stretches, specifically in the Andaman Nicobar, Lakshadweep and all the small islands, except all those areas which have already been designated under CRZ 1, 2 and 3. So, category 4 is basically for Andaman, Nicobar, Lakshadweep and other small islands. So, these were the 4 categories. Let us very briefly talk about the evolution of these norms. Now, the first coastal zone regulation rules were made in the year 1991 under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. And the main aim of these 1991 rules was to restrict certain kind of activities like large constructions, setting up of new industries, storage or disposal of hazardous material, mining, etc. within a certain specified distance from the coastline. However, what was lacking in these rules was that these rules were so stringent that they would not allow even simple things like building a decent home for people living close to the coast and carrying out basic development work. So rather than simplifying this process, these rules created hurdles for the industrial as well as infrastructure project which aimed at social development. Then the next set of rules came out in 2011, and the 2011 rules tried to fill in some of the loopholes which existed in the 1991 rules. And this they tried to do by firstly creating a district level coastal committees, which in a way would allow the coastal communities to participate in the regulatory decision making on these coasts. But here also, in most of the states, these committees were not even functional. Hence, the 2011 rules also lacked because they created a mismatch between economic development and the coastal ecosystem conservation. Hence, finally then, in the year 2014, the Ministry of Environment set up a six-member committee under the then Earth Sciences Secretary, Sailesh Nayak, to give suggestions for a new set of on coastal zone regulation norms. And finally, last year, the Cabinet approved these coastal zone regulation norms. So let us now look at the salient features of these 2018 norms. Now the first salient feature of the 2018 norms is that it allowed for the floor space index. Now basically in 2011 notification, floor space index or the floor area ratio were frozen as per the 1991 development control regulation. Now knowing the exact definition of them is not important. Just know that these rules were related to the constructions of building. But now this 2018 notification has decided to defreeze the same and permit FSI for construction projects. Now what will happen with the FSI coming into picture is that it will enable redevelopment of the coastal areas to meet the emerging needs. So basically earlier since the FSI was frozen, the redevelopment of areas around the coastal area was not possible. But now the 2018 norms have allowed for the FSI. So hence we can have redevelopment of the coastal areas. Secondly, what they have done is all those densely populated rural areas will be given greater opportunity for development. Now if you remember, we had studied that rural areas come under category 3. Further, for the rural areas under category 3, two separate categories have been stipulated. The first is CRZ3A. And these would include all those densely populated rural areas who have a population density of 2161 per square kilometer. Now all such areas having such high population density, there will be a no development zone of 50 meters from the high tide line as against the 200 meters from the high tide line which was stipulated in the 2011 notification. So basically in the 2011 notification, the no development zone extended from the high tide line to up to 200 meters. But now under the new regulation, the no development zone will extend from the high tide line to up to 50 meters. And the reason for reducing the no development zone is that all such densely populated rural areas have same characteristics as the urban areas. And secondly, for category 3B, it stated all those rural areas who have a population density of below 2161 per square kilometer will continue to have no development zone of 200 meters from the high tide line. So basically rural areas also have been classified into two categories, wherein category A will have no development zone of 50 meters and category B will continue to have for 200 meters as was stated under the 2011 notification. The third salient feature is that these norms try to promote tourism infrastructure. So now in order to promote tourism, these norms have said that temporary tourist facilities like shacks, toilets, changing room, drinking water facility, etc. can be permitted on the beaches. And all such temporary tourism facilities are permissible under the no development zone of the CZR3 areas as per the notification. But having allowed temporary tourism facilities, the notifications state that a minimum distance of 10 meters from the high tide line should be maintained for setting up of such facilities. So the third salient feature was the promotion of tourism, where temporary tourist facilities are allowed within the no development zone, but they have to keep a distance of 10 meters from the high tide line. The fourth salient feature is that the clearances related to these regulations have been streamlined. So now the clearance process has been divided into two. Now all those projects which are located in the zone 1 and in the zone 4, the clearances for such projects shall be dealt by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Whereas all the clearances related to zone 2 and zone 3 have been delegated at the state level with necessary guidance. So now for zone 2 and zone 3, it is the state governments which will be providing clearances. And for the Zone 1 and the Zone 4, Union Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change will continue to provide clearance. The fifth salient feature is that a no development zone of 20 meters has been stipulated for all islands. So the notification states that realizing that there is a space limitation and a very unique geography of island areas, it has been decided that all those islands which are close to the mainland and all the backwater islands in the mainland will have a no development zone of 20 meters. So in the earlier regulation, the no development zone varied for the islands. But now in the new 2018 norms, the no development zone has become uniform, which is 20 meters from the high tide line. Sixth is that all ecological sensitive areas have been accorded special importance, and therefore special guidelines related to their conservation and management have been drawn up as part of the coastal regulation zone notification. And the last salient feature is that considering the impacts of climate change, the government has accorded special focus to pollution abatement. Hence, in order to address the problem of pollution in coastal area, the setting up of treatment facilities have been made permissible in CRZ1, but then again, subject to necessary safeguards. So this was all about the coastal zone regulation notification. With this, let's move on to our next news. This news has been taken from page number 2. And it reads, Heritage Bylaws for Purana Kila, Shersha Gate, Khairul Manzil tabled. Now the context of the news is that the heritage bylaws for three monuments in Delhi, which have been drafted in accordance with the provisions of the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment and Validation Act of 2010, have been tabled in the parliament. Now these bylaws have been drafted by the National Monuments Authority. Now let us understand what is the need for having such heritage bylaws. Now basically, around a monument, there are two kinds of areas. One is a prohibited area and the second is the regulated area. Now a prohibited area is the one which starts from a protected area or a protected monument up till 100 meters. Now under this prohibited area, only the Archaeological Survey of India can carry out repair works. Further, the area which starts from 100 meters from such a monument, that is from where the prohibited area ends, up till 300 meters away from it, is known as the regulated area. And it is for this regulated area that the National Monument Authority is drafting heritage bylaws for each monument or group of monuments so that the nature of new construction activity around such areas or monuments can be determined. And these proposed bylaws will lay down restrictions on the height of new construction around these monuments. Hence, we can say that the main aim of these heritage bylaws is to ensure that this new construction is in harmony with the protected monuments. So basically, you need to remember under which act is the heritage bylaws being drafted, and the act is Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act. Now, as far as the National Monument Authority is concerned, it is a statutory body which was established in the year 2010 under the Ancient Monument and Archaeological Sites Remains Amendment and Validation Act of 2010. The main idea behind establishing this authority was to stop the rampant encroachment and the construction around the monuments and other sites of archaeological importance. Further, the National Monument Authority is the highest body to oversee the function under the AMASAR Act, and particularly this authority grants the no objection certification for construction or repair works in the prohibited and regulated areas. Lastly, this authority functions under the Union Ministry of Culture. So this was all about this news article. With this, let's move on to our practice questions. Now, based on our today's discussion, here is the first set of your prelims practice question. Please pause the video and solve them. We'll discuss the answer after 5 seconds. The first question is related with the office of the whip. The first statement reads, Office of whip has been specified under the Lok Sabha rules. Now, this is incorrect. The office of whip has not been provided for either under the constitution or under the Lok Sabha rules. Second, only the ruling party has an office of whip. This is also incorrect. All political parties, including the ruling party and the opposition, have an office of whip. Hence, the right answer to this question is D, neither one nor two. Question number 2 is related to to the anti-defection laws. The first statement, a member disqualified under anti-defection cannot contest election for the entire pending duration of the house. Now this is incorrect. Disqualification under the anti-defection law does not mean that a member has become ineligible to contest elections. In fact, the member can contest the by-election which is being held for the seat which was just vacated by him. Second, a member can be disqualified for disobeying the whip of his party. Now this is correct. If a member votes or does not vote on the directions given by his party, then that can be a ground of disqualification under the anti-defection law. Hence, the right answer to this question is B, 2 only. Now, here is the second set of prelims practice question. Please again pause the video and solve them. We'll discuss the answer after 5 seconds. Question number 3 reads, which of the following companies have to abide by the corporate social responsibility norms under the Companies Act of 2013? The first option is net worth of 500 crores. This is correct. Second, 1000 crore turnover. This is right. Third, 50 crore net profit. Now this is incorrect. It is not 50, but 5 crores of net profit. Hence the right answer to this question becomes B, 1 and 2 only. Question number 4 is in relation with the National Financial Reporting Authority. The first statement, it has been established under an executive order. Now this is incorrect. The NFRA is a statutory body and has been established under the Companies Act of 2013. Second statement, it has no power to take suo motu cognizance of a matter. This is incorrect. It has the power to take suo motu cognizance of a matter. Hence, the right answer to this question becomes D, neither one nor two. With this, we come to an end for today's discussion. Let's move to the question for the day.